people are still finishing up, there is an extra assignment that is mandatory for honor students. It has been passed out. This is a story called Federigo's Falcon. We'll be discussing it in class next week. If you're standard and you would like to do this for extra credit, see me after class and I'll give you a copy of the story. What's going to happen is I would like you all to have it read by Friday. If it is on your desk already, you must have it read by Friday. I'll give out a set of discussion questions so that you can reread it with those questions in mind. But it's really important. This story usually takes a few times to parse out. So if you actually read it more than once, you'll be able to contribute to discussion. When we have discussion with everybody who's taken up the story, you will be required to speak at least once in discussion. So please be prepared. Don't come in and not have read it. And that'll be at some point during this week. So does everybody understand what they're supposed to do with that? You can ask Miss Joyce about that. Everyone's like, why is it stapled?
Oh, it's too easy.
So is everybody good? We can wake up now. It's all good. There's no more quizzing. And we can move on. Now, I think you guys said we're finished with Canto 5?
Yes.
We're done. Do you have any questions about the reading guide for Canto 5? Because y'all are just ahead and taking care of business. Is there anything on the reading guide that you're especially confused about for Canto 5?
Okay. Did you get number 3?
This is one that I kind of like, it's mostly based on your interpretation. Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14 states, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Compare this verse to Minos' statements in 19 through 20. And in 19 through 20, Minos says, don't be misled by that wide and easy passage. So do you see anything similar with those two statements that I just read? These ideas of roads being wide and easy, that means that they're the ones that are most likely to lead to sin. If it's an easy road, then it is one of the ones that's most likely going to get you down to hell. The road that is hard, that is crooked, that is skinny, that's the road, that's the virtuous road. And though it might be harder to get through it at the end of the day, you will eventually get to a virtuous place. Does that make any sense? I just want to understand that you guys see that there is a parallel between that and this is a biblical reference.
Numbers 5 and 7.
Give examples of four souls from their actions and their actions from 52 to 72. If we finish this canto, we read this yesterday. So does anybody have any ideas of people who we ran into in those 20 lines?
Oh, we ran into some of them. We lost track.
You didn't raise your hand.
You did not raise your hand. That's a very good point. Alex.
Lovers.
Lovers. What kind of, who were they? We listed like 6 of them.
All right,
like, Wilson?
People like Cleopatra and Helen and Achilles, and then they're like Paris and Tristan.
Awesome.
They're all like people from history.
Wonderful. Like, yeah, we have a lot of people. Semiramis, Cleopatra, people you've mentioned. Do you have any other input there? Perfect. So those are the lovers. Those are the souls that I'm talking about in question 5. Question 7, I believe we answered on the way out the door. Can you tell me what a panderer is?
Oh, I know what it is.
Kelsey.
A panderer is someone who pushes sexual acts.
Very good. Thank you. Yes. A panderer is someone who pushes or encourages people to do bad acts, usually sexual acts. So someone who encourages these bad activities. Does anyone remember where pandering came up in Canto 5?
No.
Anyone? Do you have an idea?
Cleopatra.
Not Cleopatra. It's in the story that Francesca is telling us. Do we know who might be a panderer in that story? All right, Kelsey.
I believe it's her lover, Paolo.
All right, we're going to go into this. It is not her lover, Paolo. They talk about reading the stories of Lancelot and Guinevere, and that whoever wrote those stories is a panderer. The person who writes these stories is someone who, because their books are so full of love and carnal thoughts, they're pushing the people who read them to do these naughty things. They're pushing and encouraging these people to partake in these acts.
Like 50 Shades of Grey.
Sorry, Nathan?
Like 50 Shades of Grey would be a good
example? That, yeah, they would say that the author of 50 Shades of Grey would be a panderer. He is encouraging people.
So he's going to hell.
he's a panderer. I mean, in Dante's version, yes, panderers are. Does anyone remember what circle panderers are in? No, panderers are actually very, very low because they're intentionally doing this. I believe they're in level 7. Yeah, they're down there with all the liars. So they're doing something on purpose. They have intent. What was the difference with the people in circle 2? Why do we pity them? Does anybody know?
Because they're burning the hell.
Well, I mean, Dante specifically pities them for a different reason. Emma.
Because they couldn't control themselves.
Because they couldn't control themselves. Lust was not an intentional thought that they had. Lust just kind of overtook them. So, to give us examples of this today, I want us to talk about a whole bunch of these people who were in the poem and the people that we referenced for number 5. So we're going to start that by talking about Guinevere and Lancelot. Does anyone have an idea of who Guinevere and Lancelot are? Do you have any new faces to know? It's okay. We'll see.
They're from Arthurian legend, and Lancelot was a knight of the Round Table who
yes.
fell in love with Arthur's queen.
Yes.
And they did many things.
They did many things. All right. And can anyone tell us why that would put you in Dante's version of hell?
Because they did many things.
Because they did many things with married people.
Yeah.
Not okay. Hannah?
It's adultery.
It's adultery. Thank you. All right. So the idea is hopefully you guys know a little bit about the story of Lancelot and Guinevere. If you don't, that's fine. But,
thank you.
I just wanted to play you a little song about
thank
them.
A song.
I'll try and scroll through the lyrics, but you should be able to understand it. Them or made them think about what we're talking about in this class. One of my favorite things it says, "Shan't I be young before I'm old?" What do you think this is talking about if this young woman is singing this? She wants to be a little crazy. She wants to get a little bit rowdy. She wants to be in love before she has to be locked up in a tower like an old queen. Guinevere was known to be extremely young when she got married, so she wants the chance to fall in love. And we talked about how she was Arthur's queen. How would you become someone's queen in Arthurian times? Did she fall in love with Arthur? No, she got an arranged marriage with this guy. She didn't ever have the chance to fall in love. This song is called The Simple Joys of Maidenhood. And it's all about how she wants the chance to have the first kiss with somebody that she knows and loves and grows to, you know, be fond of. And so I thought this was an interesting way of seeing it, because in Dante's version, we do see these people tortured and looked down upon for their sins, when this is just a girl who wants her chance at love. She's probably 15 or 16 when singing this song.
It doesn't sound good, didn't she?
Well, 15 and 16 meant a different thing in Arthurian times. So we have that. If you would all open your folders to your class copy set, we have a poem by Tennyson. You'll have two poems in there, maybe. If you have two, pull up the Tennyson poem. Ooh. All right. So we have a poem that tells the story of Sir Lancelot and Queen Guinevere. Now, because I've been reading all the cantos, I would love if you guys would like to read. If you don't, that's fine. I can do it. But is there anyone who would like to volunteer and read part of this poem? Nobody? Nobody wants to? Nathan, you would like to read. JP, I saw your hand shooting up.
No, you didn't.
No, I did. I'm really excited about it. Nathan, will you read the first side? And when we all flip, and I expect to hear all of your pages turning because you're reading along, then JP will take the back side for us. So, together. Nathan, please speak up so that everybody can hear you.
Like souls that balance joy and pain, with tears and smiles from heaven again, the maiden spring upon the plain came in a sunlit fall of rain. In a crystal vapor everywhere, blue isles of heaven lapped between. And far in forest deeps unseen, the topmost elm tree gathered green from my drops of balmy air. Sometimes the linnet piped his song, sometimes the throstle whistled strong, sometimes the sparhawk wheeled along, hushed all these groans from fear of wrong. By grassy capes with fuller sound and curves, the yellowing river ran and drooping chestnut buds began to spread into the perfect fan above the teeming ground. Then in the boyhood of the year, Sir Lancelot and Queen Guinevere rode through the coverts of the deer with blissful treble ringing clear. She seemed a part of joyous spring, a gown of grass green silk she wore, buckled with golden claps before, a light green tuft of plume she bore.
Oh, after that. Close in the golden river.
Speak that up for us.
Oh. Clothes in a golden river.
Ring.
Ring.
It's all right, we understand.
Now some twisted ivy net. Now by some twinkling river wet. Yeah. And mosses mixed with violet. Her cream white mule is pastern set. And fleeter now she skimmed the plains, and she was an athlete, Princess Springs, by night to Erie, walking. When all the glimmering moorland rings with jingling, brittle
rings.
As she fled fast through sun and shade, the happy winds upon her play, blowing the ringlet from the braid, she looked so lovely. As she swayed, the ring with dainty fingertips, a man had given all her bliss and all his worldly worth for this, to taste his whole heart in one kiss upon her perfect lips.
Thank you, boys, for reading. All right. We should clap for